So some questions that we often get from customers or potential customers about the system, we'll go through some of those right now. So one, or the first being cleaning, and how cleaning works and how often you need to clean, and you know, is it manual, is it automated, etc. So with the cleaning, as I've mentioned, there's the cleaning detergent is stored inside the LSM, and there's two different detergents. So there's two different containers in here. There's detergent one and detergent two. So detergent one is a more dilute, concentration of the detergent. So it's a 0.05%, it's a 0.5%, 0.5% detergent solution. And detergent two is a 2% solution. So there's a basic clean and an advanced clean option. And those are manual cleans. Now, you can set up the cleaning to clean after every sample. You can set it up to clean between product group changes. You can set it up to be automated, manual or automated. So there's different options for the cleaning. And the recommendation that I would have is it's going to be dependent on the product. So for a cream sample or a sample that's got a lot of lactose in it, I would recommend cleaning after every sample, because those types of samples are what have the potential to clog some of these lines. So if we clean them, they're never going to clog the line, right? There's also an emergency clean, and that emergency clean time is customizable. So normally it's by default it's set at 10 minutes. I have some customers who drop it all the way to the minimum, which would be 1 minute. So therefore, every time they run a sample, even if they walk away, a minute later they know it's going to do a clean. It's actually, when it does the emergency clean, it's doing an advanced clean. So it's really cleaning out those lines really well. So the answer there is there's a number of options, manual or automated. It's going to depend on your comfort level with the system and really what products you're running. So the conversation needs to be around what you're running, and then we can give you a really good option or an answer for how often you should be cleaning. But more cleaning is never going to hurt anything. So if you are worried about it, clean more is the answer there. The next question we get a lot is about calibration. So what do we have for calibrations? Can we build new calibrations? What does that look like? And that kind of rolls into the next question, which is application support. So the first one, for most commodity dairy products, we're going to have calibrations. So milk, that could be raw milk, skim milk, whole milk, UF milk, all those milk products we're going to have calibrations for. They're ready to go. Whey products, cream, cheese, milk powders, whey powders, all of those we're going to have calibrations for. If you have a somewhat unique product among those, maybe we need to tweak those, and we can do that. So we have an application staff. We have a minimum of 3 people on our application staff, up to 5. And so there's a number of staff that are dedicated to helping you build out these calibrations. And really what that looks like, you run some samples, you get reference chemistry done, you kind of put that together for us, and we take that data, we add it to calibrations specifically for you. And so that all that can even be set up ahead of a purchase. So even before your instrument arrives on site, you can send us samples to run. Now that's assuming that the samples are stable in transit, etc. So some of this stuff has to be done on site, because if it cools down, it will crystallize, etc., etc. But a lot of that is done ahead of time. And for the commodity stuff, we're already going to have those calibrations pre-built. The next question, maybe the last one we get, is about warranty. So everything you see is going to have a standard 12-month warranty. So, you know, you get an instrument and, a month later the pipette falls off and is damaged or something. We're going to replace that. We're going to fix that up to the 12 months, right? And then there's a couple of internal components that have longer warranties. So the interferometer, so the wavelength selecting device inside the spectrometer itself, that has a 10-year warranty. And then really that's an indication of how long we expect these instruments to last. We expect them to last 10 years plus, right? And then there's also a laser, which is part of the Fourier transform technology. Those lasers also have a 10-year warranty. So that's, you know, we expect it to last the lifetime of the instrument. The lifetime of that instrument is going to be 10 years plus. I guess there's maybe one more question that we get quite a bit. I mentioned during the demo, on the liquid side, we don't need to do any biasing. We don't need to do slope offset adjustment. The reason we don't need to do that is because of the quartz flow cell we're using isn't going to wear down over time. And the reason you have to bias or slope offset adjust on a conventional mid-infrared system is because they're using calcium fluoride flow cells that will wear over time. So we eliminate the bias adjustment because we're using quartz. We can use quartz because we're using near-infrared. Now, using near-infrared means we can also do solids analysis. So if you look at other cheese analyzers, milk powder analyzers that are on the market, those are also near-infrared devices. Most of them, or a lot of them, you're going to have to bias or modify the calibrations over time. And that's because of the type of near-infrared technology they're using. So we're using Fourier transform near-infrared. Other analyzers on the market are going to use a dispersive type near-infrared. And that can be a dispersive type near-infrared. It could be a scanning monochromator near-infrared. And those are both dispersive. And you're going to have to bias those calibrations over time because the instrument itself will not be stable. With an FT system, the spectrometer is expected to be stable. So if I build a calibration today, you know, in a month it's going to give me the same numbers. In 2 months, it's going to be the same numbers. In a year or 2 years, it's going to give you the same numbers. You're not going to have to kind of chase a bias around because the spectrometer itself is changing. And you know, it's because of the FT technology. With that technology, we have the ability to change resolution with these diode array or scanning monochromator systems. They have a fixed resolution, okay? So they're not able to accurately calibrate their x-axis, so it can kind of move around a little bit. So how do you know, the wavelength that you're looking at is really the wavelength? How do you know that the instrument hasn't changed at all? With this, we can vary that resolution. We can have a very high resolution, and we can look at a standard, and our standard is water, so water vapor, and it's always at the same place every time. So that's how we know that the instrument's not changing, and that's what, you know, that's really the core behind how we don't, or why we don't have to change calibrations or biases over time. The spectrometer hasn't changed, therefore the calibration has no need to change. Hey everyone, thanks for watching that demonstration of the MPA 2D. If you're interested in learning more information, please see the links in the description. Thanks.